I think we can start the next conference of Etienne Guis, that is professor at the École Normale Supérieure de Lyon. But I'm sure that the IMPA community also consider him as an honorable member.
Thank you.
We'll talk
Thank
about
you.
Poincaré and probability.
Thank you very much. So the first thing I should say is that my title is not original at all. 5 days ago, there was a talk in Paris, in a similar meeting by Percy Diaconis. The title was the same. And 4 days ago, also in Paris, in the same room, there was a title. There was a talk by Masliak with the same title, again, in French. And what I want to do today is to restrict myself to a small part of this probability business and to concentrate on the dynamical part of probability theory. At the end of the talk of Diaconis 5 days ago, he mentioned that, according to him, nobody had read the last chapter of the book of Poincaré on probability. This is not true. I read it. So what I want to do is to discuss basically this final chapter of this book, and more precisely to try to convince you that the contribution of Poincaré to dynamical system and probability and ergodic theory is not reduced to the Poincaré recurrence theorem. Usually people claim that the contribution of Poincaré is essentially the Poincaré recurrence theorem. I want to convince you that he went much further. Even he stated the Birkhoff ergodic theorem, and more importantly, he gave us some tools to attack this Boltzmann ergodicity conjecture. So I want to read with you some of his contributions. Of course, as I told you, I'm far from being the first studying Poincaré and probability. Here are some references, a paper by Pierre Cartier, also analyzing this book of Poincaré, but unfortunately, for some reason, he used the first edition of this book in which the last chapter is not there. And also, I want to mention this wonderful PhD thesis by Anne Robadet, which unfortunately is not published. It is a shame. So everybody wanting this PhD asked me, I sent a copy. You could ask her, but she's in a convent. Is it true? She's still in Chartreuse, yes? What? Anyway, that's not important. And the last reference is very fresh because it's a talk that Masliak gave 4 days ago. I think you can find it on the website of Bourbaki and not Bourbaki. It's really a remarkable text that I believe is the best text on the question. The contributions of Poincaré on probability are very small when you speak on the size. You have his lecture notes from the course that he gave in Sorbonne in 1893 and 1894. And this was published as a book in 1896, and as a second edition with one more chapter in 1911. And also, he published two popular essays on probability. One of them is published in La Science et l'Hypothèse, and the other one is published in several places, including in the Science et Méthode later in 1908. These two popular texts are really wonderful. I mean, I decided to put quotations here in French because this is part of the pleasure. The quality of the French is so beautiful that it would be a shame to translate into English. So I decided to keep it here. So let me begin by Poincaré recurrence theorem. As you know, this Poincaré recurrence theorem was stated in his memoir on the three-body problem. And as you all know, there are two versions of this memoir. The first version with a mistake, and the second version with, so to speak, corrected mistakes. And what is interesting is to compare the status of the Poincaré recurrence theorem in both versions of the same paper. As a theorem, as a statement, they are just identical. You have the theorem claiming that if you have a fluid moving in a container, if the volume is finite, and if you pick a point, the volume is preserved, then if you pick any small region, you can be sure that inside this region, there is at least one point that comes back to the original region infinitely many often. This is the same formulation in the two versions of the paper. However, in the second version, it was much more important for him to convince the reader that this theorem is important. In version number one, he was proving the wrong theorem about the stability of the solar system. And in version number two, the stability was not a theorem anymore. So it was important for him to convince the reader that this theorem is some kind of stability, and that was discussed yesterday by Alain. It's the Poisson stability. So somehow this theorem was more important in the second version than in the first version. And he had to convince the reader that indeed the points that come back to the original domain are more frequent than the points that do not come back. And then you have this addendum that you find only in the second version, which says that trajectories that do not come back should be considered as exceptional trajectories. And then he is in front of the problem, how can I convince the reader that these exceptional things are really indeed exceptional? And this is the first time in his life in which he writes the word probabilité. So here he says, he uses the terminology of probability. Nous conviendrons de dire que la probabilité pour que blah, 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 blah. So he used the terminology of probability to convince the reader that almost surely trajectories are coming back to the original point. And this is fundamental for him to convince the reader of the power of the theorem. So as far as I know, this is the first use of the word probability in Poincaré's paper. Of course, as we have mentioned several times here, at the time, he was professor in Sorbonne, in charge of the chair de physique mathématique et probabilité. Even though he was really not interested by probability at first. So some of the writers, in particular Masliac, comments that somehow Poincaré was forced to go to probability because it was his job. He had to teach probability. He was not really interested by probability, but somehow, he had to teach it, this structure of probability came to his way of thinking and became important in his work. Much later, he was using the word probability in this context in a very, very natural and beautiful way. So here's a way Poincaré is expressing the Liouville theorem. The Liouville theorem states that when you look at the Hamiltonian differential equation, the flow of this Hamiltonian differential equation is preserving the volume. Liouville had basically proved it, but somehow did not understand it. Poincaré was the first to understand it and to put it in the right context and switching from the word volume to the word probability. So here's the way he's expressing that. Dans la dynamique classique, on se sert de ce théorème que deux états physiques dont l'un est l'effet nécessaire de l'autre sont également probables. This is just the most beautiful way of expressing Liouville theorem. The future has the same probability as the past. Dans ce système physique, si on représente par Q l'une des coordonnées généralisées et par P le moment correspondant, d'après le théorème de Liouville, by the way, he mentions the name of Liouville, which was not the case in his paper on the three-body problem. Le domaine dp dq, considéré à un instant quelconque, est un invariant par rapport au temps. D'autre part, p et q peuvent, à un instant donné, prendre toutes les valeurs possibles indépendamment l'un de l'autre, d'où il suit que le domaine élémentaire de probabilité est infiniment petit de la grandeur dp dq. So he is just mixing or switching from the word volume to the word probability, and this is a major step. Okay, so this is the first instance of probability is in the context of recurrence theory. Now, Poincaré teaches us two main tools for understanding randomness. And this, I think, is really remarkable. He says, randomness comes from instability. And instability comes from expansion. So this is the credo, which is so familiar in this house. If you want to prove ergodicity, you have to prove some instability. If you want to prove instability, you have to find some positive Lyapunov exponent. You have to prove some expansion in the dynamics. And he explains that very wonderfully. Here is this. This is the famous sentence that one could compare with the famous butterfly effect, except that it was written in 1892 or something, and a butterfly effect was in 1963 or something. So he explains that pourquoi les météorologistes ont-ils tant de peine à prédire le temps avec quelque certitude. Pourquoi les chutes de pluie, les tempêtes elles-mêmes, nous semblent-elles arriver au hasard, de sorte que bien des gens trouvent tout naturel de prier pour avoir la pluie ou le beau temps, alors qu'ils jugeraient ridicule de demander une éclipse par une prière. Nous voyons que les grandes perturbations se produisent généralement dans les régions où l'atmosphère est en équilibre instable. Les météorologistes voient bien que cet équilibre est instable, qu'un cyclone va naître quelque part, mais où ils sont hors d'état de le dire. Un dixième de degré en plus ou en moins, en un point quelconque, le cyclone éclate ici et non là. It's very close to the butterfly in Brazil generating a tornado in Texas. By the way, you have noticed that this sentence, butterfly in Brazil, tornado in Texas, if you Google that, you see all variations, but there is something common. The butterfly is not always in Brazil, but it's always in the third world. And the catastrophe is always in America, and sometimes in Paris. No comment, okay. You can try on Google, that's very interesting. Okay, un dixième, Si on avait connu ce dixième de degré, on aurait pu le savoir d'avance, mais les observations n'étaient ni assez serrées, ni assez précises, et c'est pour cela que tout semble dû à l'intervention du hasard. Ici encore, nous retrouvons le même contraste entre une cause minime, inappréciable pour l'observateur, et des effets considérables qui sont quelquefois d'épouvantables désastres. So his first message to us is that the origin of randomness is lack of knowledge. And lack of knowledge accompanied by sensitivity to initial condition. Sensitivity to initial condition implies randomness. What? This quote is science et l'hypothèse. Actually, since he likes to make a connection with other fields, I just wanted to quote another relation. He doesn't hesitate to apply this kind of idea to history. Look at this quotation. C'est la même chose dans les sciences morales, et en particulier dans l'histoire. L'historien est obligé de faire un choix dans les événements de l'époque qu'il étudie. Il ne raconte que ceux qui lui semblent les plus importants. Il s'est donc contenté de relater les événements les plus considérables du XVIe siècle, par exemple, de même que les faits les plus remarquables du XVIIe siècle. Si les premiers suffisent pour expliquer les seconds, on dit que ceux-ci sont conformes aux lois de l'histoire. Mais si un grand événement du XVIIe siècle reconnaît pour cause un petit fait du XVIe siècle, qu'aucune histoire ne rapporte, que tout le monde a négligé, alors on dit que cet événement est dû au hasard. Ce mot a donc le même sens que dans les sens physiques, il signifie que de petites causes ont produit de grands effets. So for Poincaré, randomness is somehow equivalent to sensitivity to initial conditions. Okay, so that's the first part of the message. But the second part is really much, much more important for us. And I think nobody listened to him. He says, okay, things are random, but we should use this randomness as a source of knowledge. And he has also a wonderful way to say it, and I will explain that better later. This beautiful sentence. Vous me demandez de vous prédire les phénomènes qui vont se produire. Si, par malheur, je connaissais les lois de ces phénomènes, je ne pourrais y arriver que par des calculs inextricables et je devrais renoncer à vous répondre. Mais comme j'ai la chance de les ignorer, je vais vous répondre tout de suite. Et ce qu'il y a de plus extraordinaire, c'est que ma réponse sera juste. So he says, randomness, instability, expansion, this implies some kind of statistical law. We have to use randomness, we would say today, we have to use ergodicity as a positive tool. Usually people in the popular presentation present chaos theory as something negative. We cannot predict the future. But Poincaré tells us, it's good news. The more chaotic, the more predictable it is. And this is very explicit in Poincaré's texts. So he gives us a certain number of examples. I want to, basically he gives three examples. I want to explain the first one. Or maybe two, depending on time. The first one is very famous, it's called the roulette. I don't know if there's an English word for that, roulette. Is there an English? Same word? Roulette. Yeah. You like to copy our language, eh? So the thing is this, you have a wheel. It is decomposed into sectors, many sectors. Sectors are black and red, black, red, etc., etc. So you have an even number of sectors, and the wheel can rotate, and at some point you spin it, and you let it turn, and you wait until it stops. And when it stops, you look at the position of this needle here. If it's black, you win. If it's red, you lose. And the question is, how can I guarantee that the probability of black is 1/2? For what kind of reason can I say that the probability of black is 1/2? Recently, I was discussing that with Alain Cohn, and he told me, well, what else could it be? So he was using some kind of old-fashioned philosophical argument, a principe de raison suffisante. If there is no reason to believe that they are different, they should be equal. It makes no sense. We have to prove something. Why is it true that the roulette is functioning properly? And then Poincaré gives the proof of that. And the proof, I will sketch it for you, but the proof depends on some kind of assumption, une convention. So here is the theorem. When I spin the roulette, and I look at the angle where the roulette will stop, I get some probability distribution on the circle. There is some probability distribution, let me call it mu, is the probability on the circle. It's the probability that the roulette will stop at some angle theta. The problem is that I have no idea about this probability. And what I have to know, if this probability will give 1/2 measure for the black and 1/2 measure for the red. The point is that we know that the sectors are very small. So we would like to consider the number of sectors to go to infinity. This is equivalent to look at the self-covering map from the circle to itself, which is multiplication by n. Theta goes to n theta. And the problem we are looking at is, what can I say about the direct image of this measure mu by this map? What can I say about that? Now, the theorem of Poincaré is that this converges when n goes to infinity to the Lebesgue measure on the circle. Of course, it cannot be true this way. So the theorem is, this converges in the weak topology to the Lebesgue measure. We need some assumption, because, for example, I could take as a measure mu the Dirac mass at the origin, and I can multiply it by n, it's always the Dirac mass. But Poincaré says, I make the convention that the measure mu has some density with respect to the Lebesgue measure, and that this density is continuous. So this is the convention. I assume that mu has the form f of theta d theta, where f is continuous. And then he proves that if you take a measure on the circle with continuous density, and if you push it forward by an n star with n big enough, it converges to Lebesgue measure. And this is a 100% satisfying proof. And this proves somehow that the black has 1/2 probability. Actually, today it's an exercise to give a necessary and sufficient condition for this to be true. And I give you this an exercise. This holds true if and only if the k Fourier coefficients of the measure mu tend to infinity when k tends to zero when k tends to infinity.
Does it use any information about the actual physics?
No, no, that's the point. He knows nothing about it except that he makes the convention, the assumption, that it is given by some density. And he proves that the result, the limiting result, is independent on the initial condition. So this is exactly what he was saying in his joke. You asked me for computing the future. If I knew the law, I could work a lot, and it would be difficult. But I'm lucky enough. I don't know, but I know the answer. That's the point. So that's what he does. And then he makes some comments about this convention. So this is the definition of the roulette. I like this sentence too. Ce sont là des différences que le sens musculaire ne peut apprécier et qui échapperaient même à des instruments plus délicats. Il m'est donc impossible de prévoir ce que va faire l'aiguille que je viens de lancer. Et c'est pourquoi mon cœur bat. Et j'attends tout du hasard. La différence dans la cause est imperceptible et la différence dans l'effet est pour moi de la plus haute importance, puisqu'il s'agit de mon argent. Then he makes some comments about this convention. Look at that. He says, je ne me suis imposé que de faibles restrictions en supposant que la fonction phi de A, which is my function f, est continue et périodique, et ces hypothèses sont tellement naturelles qu'on se demande comment on pourrait y échapper. Just by the way, I want to mention that it is unclear to me whether or not Poincaré had understood that some measures have no density. It's unclear to me that Poincaré could manipulate a probability measure on the circle, for example, with full support and orthogonal to the Lebesgue measure. Anyway, so he's making this assumption, and then he makes a comment that physically it should be true, and he says this: il y a 50 ans, les physiciens considéraient une loi simple comme plus probable qu'une loi compliquée. Toute chose égale d'ailleurs. Ils invoquaient même ce principe en faveur de la loi de Mariotte contre les expériences de Reynaud. Aujourd'hui, ils ont répudié cette croyance. Que de fois pourtant ne se sont-ils pas sentis obligés d'agir comme s'ils l'avaient conservé. Quoi qu'il en soit, ce qui reste de cette tendance, c'est la croyance en la continuité. Et nous venons de voir que si cette croyance disparaissait à son tour, la science expérimentale deviendrait impossible. I think that this faith in continuity, today we could translate it into the faith in the Lebesgue measure. The faith in the Lebesgue measure is something which is so important, for example, in IMPA. The Lebesgue measure, it's a fundamental question. Is dynamical system related or not to the Lebesgue measure? I mean, all these Sinai, Ruelle, Bowen, etc., is based on the principle, on the convention, that the Lebesgue measure is there, and is the fundamental physical fact. The role of the Lebesgue measure in physics is still today a very important question, and we could have a lot of debates about it. The second example, let me give the third example. The third example is the example on cards shuffling. In this example, Poincaré proves a theorem, or better, claims a theorem, which indeed he proves in the one of the last chapters of his book. It is the following. You take n cards, and you play the following game. You choose some permutations, sigma 1, sigma 2, let's say two permutations, which are permutations of the n cards, and you attribute to these two permutations a probability, P1 and P2. P1 plus P2 is equal to 1. And now you play the following game. You take your deck of cards, and at each second, you choose permutation sigma 1 or permutation sigma 2 with probability P1 or P2. And you do it again and again and again and again. So you shuffle your cards randomly according to this probability P1, P2, and sigma 1, sigma 2. And the theorem is, even if I don't know P1, P2, even if I don't know sigma 1 and sigma 2, I know where the probability is going. The theorem is that almost surely the deck of cards is converging to equidistribution. Equidistribution, you see, it's very similar to I don't know what the measure mu is, but I know the limit. Here, this is the same. I don't know what is the rules of the games. I don't know sigma 1, sigma 2. I don't know P1, P2. But I know where it's going. It's going to equidistributions. Of course, there are counterexamples to this statement. And Poincaré mentions that. Of course, if the group generated by sigma 1 and sigma 2 is a strict subgroup of the group of permutations, when you compose these permutations, you will not visit all the full symmetric group. You will only visit the subgroup. And this is a special case. Typically, if you take two random permutations, they probably will generate the full group. And Poincaré proves the following statement: unless something special happens. He says this way. And then he says, well, what do I mean by something special? And he says, what I mean by something special is there is some invariant function. In other words, he says, if you play the game, random game, if there is no invariant function, you have the convergence of the Birkhoff sums. So he is really proving the Birkhoff ergodic theorem in a special case. When you play a random game, if there is no invariant functions, you converge to a limit, which is exactly the statement of Birkhoff theory. I will be more precise in a second. Now let me go to the last chapter of his book that unfortunately Diaconis did not open, and that Cartier did not look at because he opened the wrong edition of the book. Who is speaking? I should say P1 and P2 are not zero. Is what your question?
No. When you said I'm sure, there are exceptions.
Yes, but they have zero probability. Right. Yeah. The exceptions have zero probability.
Right,
but there are exceptions. For example, you could be silly and always use σ1. σ1, 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 but this has zero probability. Okay, so let me go to the last chapter of his book. And this is really a fascinating chapter that for me was easy to read because these are things that I've been aware of. So he's discussing the following question. You take some container. This container contains a liquid, water, for example. The water is moving according to some vector field. The volume is preserved, so the divergence of the vector field is zero. He writes the equation. And then he says, let us deposit somewhere in some little domain some colored molecules. J'imagine certaines molécules du liquide qui se distinguent des autres par quelques qualités apparentes, qu'elles soient de couleur rose, par exemple, tandis que les autres sont incolores, mais qu'elles obéissent aux mêmes lois du mouvement. Au temps t égale 0, elles sont distribuées d'une manière quelconque dans le vase. L'expérience courante nous apprend beaucoup d'un certain temps. Elles sont entièrement mélangées avec les autres. Elles sont uniformément répandues dans le vase. So what Poincaré is saying is that according to experiment, if you take this domain A, and if you call phi t the flow generated by the vector field, you should expect that this domain A is mixed everywhere in the container. So you should expect what we call today mixing property. So we should expect should be mixing. And this terminology has been introduced much, much later, which means that if you take any other domain B, you expect that the volume of phi t of A intersection with B should converge when t goes to plus infinity to the volume of A times the volume of B. And indeed, he writes the equation exactly in this way, or almost exactly in this way. He expresses this. Considérons deux volumes quelconques et les probabilités correspondantes. Peut-on admettre que, quelle que soit la distribution initiale du liquide, le rapport P' sur P tend vers 1 quand T tend vers l'infini, et cela d'autant plus vite que les deux volumes seront grands et d'une forme plus simple. In other words, he's making the conjecture that a volume-preserving vector field in a domain is mixing with the modern terminology. Of course, after making this conjecture, he immediately gives a counterexample. He says, well, maybe this is too ambitious. maybe you should not expect this to convert to that. Maybe we should wait for expect less, and we would expect only this convergence in the Cesaro sense. Instead of having that, we would like to have that. This is much less, and this is what we call today ergodicity. So he says, well, maybe I'm too ambitious. I don't want to prove mixing property for fluids. I want to prove ergodicity for fluids. And then he gives two counterexamples. Counterexample one, or three counterexamples. Counterexample one is obvious. He says, if there is some function which is invariant, like, for example, the total energy, or if the container has some symmetry, or something like that, then this invariant function will confine the fluid in some subdomain, and the limit cannot be true. So we have to modify the statement, and we have to restrict it to a level surface of the invariant function. So this is his first remark. We should assume that there is no invariant function. So you see, he's really asking for the Birkhoff ergodic theorem. You assume there is no invariant function, and you want to prove the convergence of the Birkhoff sums. And then he gives two examples. One is on the torus T2, dimension 2. This is our old friend, a vector field on the torus with constant coefficients. Dx dt is alpha. Dy dt is beta. So the flow is just translating on the torus. And he makes the observation that this vector field is not mixing. Why it's not mixing? Because if you take a small ball here, and you look at the motion of this ball along the flow, it will remain a ball. It will not change its shape. So you have a small ball that will travel along the torus and definitely will not mix in the torus. So he says, OK, this is an example where this property holds, the ergodic property holds, but the mixing property does not hold. He makes that very explicit. So he gives a very explicit example of ergodic not mixing. And then he says, why? What is happening here? Why is this a counterexample? And then he says, because there is no expansion. He says, you take a ball, you look at its future, it remains a ball. When you take a general dynamical system, you should expect that little balls become ellipsoids. And the axes of the ellipsoids should go to infinity. And this should be the reason for ergodicity. So he's telling us that in order to prove ergodicity, we need to prove distortion of the derivative, which, as we know, is basically the only tool we have for proving ergodicity today. And then he finishes by another example, which is even more fascinating. It's the following. You take this torus again, and the same equation. And then you multiply this by some function. So you do not change the orbits, but you change the velocity along the orbits. And then he says, is this mixing or not? And he proves, no, he does not prove, he claims that if the alpha beta are in a Diophantine position, then it is not mixing. And if they are non-Diophantine, one can choose phi in such a way that it is mixing. Even though he is very modest, he says that he cannot complete the proof. today we know that he was right. So I wanted to tell you that in this last chapter, you have everything. You have the explicit definition of ergodicity. We have the explicit statement of Birkhoff ergodic theorem. You don't have the proof. You have the explicit definition of the mixing property. And you have a standard basic examples and counterexamples. And you have the final conjecture that it should be useful for understanding the Boltzmann-Maxwell statistical ensemble in statistical mechanics. Il y aurait donc un grand intérêt à justifier ce postulat. So, ce postulat is precisely the following. It should be true that a volume-preserving vector field should be ergodic unless there is a raison suffisante for not being ergodic. So that's the message. Dynamical systems should be ergodic unless there is a good reason for not being ergodic. Of course, he gives no proof of that, and as far as I know, it's still open today. In the case of Hamiltonian system, it's even a mistake, because we know today that because of KEM theory, we know that generic Hamiltonian dynamical systems are not ergodic. Anyway, this is a fascinating question. Let me try to give a conclusion. I think I'm not exaggerating the content of this last chapter. It seems to me that indeed he had understood the meaning of the ergodic theory, ergodic theorem, the possibility of genericity, of ergodicity in dynamical systems, in conservative dynamical systems. I think he had understood everything. And even better, he had expressed it in a very clear way. I want to finish by asking the question, how is it possible that nobody understood? I mean, he wrote in such a clear way. He did his best. He wrote a book with proofs for students, with complete proofs. And also he wrote popular essays trying to transmit his ideas. And these popular essays are not obscure. They are written in wonderful language with concrete examples in books that were published and sold in hundreds of, maybe 10, I don't know how many copies of the Science et l'Hypothèse were sold. It was a great success. So many people read the book and nobody understood. We had to wait until Birkhoff, 30 years later, it's a great mystery for me. How is it possible that after such a great effort by Poincaré, maybe it was too difficult, I don't know. Thank you very much.
Questions or comments? Alain?
Yeah, thank you very much. Well, just to answer your question as a joke, maybe the people who could understand had bought the first edition. So I have a more serious comment.
No. I wanted to say that these popular essays were widely circulated.
Right. No, it's about. It's very striking when you express that Poincaré thinks that. If there is no good reason, like an invariant function, then it should be ergodic. But in a sense, KM theorem is not a contradiction to this, because you have C-infinity invariant functions. So if you think of an analytic invariant function, it's not true. But if you are constant in the...
That's at least
for 2 degrees of freedom.
In the terminology of Poincaré, the word function is very subtle.
It's analytic.
Sometimes you say analytic and it means continuous. When it is continuous, it means analytic. And when it's a subtle question.
Right.
So he mentions the existence of invariant function. He says a univalent function.
Yes. Even more. So it's very striking that he was thinking of these invariant functions. It cannot be that he had not in the mind the non-existence of first integrals for the three-body problem, for example, and then that the recurrent theorem was the solution to this stability problem. So it's very connected, in fact.
Yeah. I just wanted to add that this allusion to the principe de raison suffisante is really there. I mean, he mentioned that dozens of times. I mean, Poincaré is really concerned with the fact that any fact should have a reason. And he mentioned the existence of this principle of sufficient reason as a driving principle in his research. So really, you could say this holds true unless there is a good reason it's not true.
Then how do you analyze Alan Cohen's answer? that maybe the answer should be that either the limit is one half or there is no limit.
I don't. No. I think the answer of Alan Cohen is due to the fact that, of course, there's some kind of symmetry between the red and the black. But you know, this is a standard mistake that scientists did during hundreds of years. This is not because the problem has a symmetry that the solution has this symmetry. You have symmetry, brisure de symétrie. How do you say that? Symmetry breaking. It is not because your problem in front of you is invariant by a symmetry that the solution is also invariant by the symmetry. You have two solutions which are just
this permuted. This is true, but if the angles were different from black and red, the answer wouldn't be the same.
It would not be the same, but I could compute it.
My question relates a little bit to it. In today, this to the sufficient reason problem, because today we call this method, which is applying here in the roulette game, the méthode de fonction arbitraire.
Yeah, right? That's interesting to note that this terminology, méthode de fonction arbitraire, that mathematicians call ergodicity.
Yeah.
I was amazed to read all these papers on méthode de fonction arbitraire, arbitrary functions. It's amazing to me to see that two communities discuss the same topics using different words.
Yeah,
so why don't you call that ergodicity?
It is being kind of discussed with probabilities also to find the reason for original or a priori probabilities, right? And to give a reason for that. And then if you look at the work, for instance, of philosophers of probability like Hans Reichenbach, they make a big fuss about that it was Poincaré who kind of gave a kind of explanation for these a priori probabilities by his mechanist approach which he had. So isn't it because he's considering the kind of initial push to the wheel and that this kind of concrete form doesn't affect the one or the 50% probability and in his book, for instance, of 1932 on probability theory and philosophy. So this has been reiterated later on also by Russian probabilists once they were no longer content with the purely axiomatic approach by Kolmogorov, right, which dissociated mechanics from probability in a certain way. So I'm wondering whether it's not historically more kind of apt, instead of speculating or interpreting your beautiful interpretation in terms of Lebesgue integral, which certainly was not in the mind of Poincaré at the time, because
technically speaking, I think I said it. It seems to me that Poincaré, when he says, "I want to assume it's a probability with a density which is continuous," it seems to me that for him it's a weak assumption.
Yeah.
For us today, mathematicians, if you take a probability on the circle, you shouldn't expect it to have a density.
Yeah.
It could be even the full support and being orthogonal to the Lebesgue measure. So I think Poincaré was lucky enough to miss these very important measures that he was not aware of.
Yeah, but it seems to me one should connect it a little bit to his general mechanistic convictions which he had, and this might also explain why he didn't see a divide between physics and probability in the sense which later probabilists saw. And this might also partly explain this kind of astonished reaction on your part and others, why he wasn't understood, because probabilists like Richard von Mises and Kolmogorov Gorov later on, they thought, well, we have to first define what probability really is, and Poincaré doesn't do it in his book. And then we can later on maybe discuss other problems, how we reconnect it to a priori probabilities.
It's obvious to me that you should have given my talk. You know much better than me. My goal here was only to try to connect from Poincaré to me, to Jacot, to all these people here, to find the heritage. I mean, what comes from Poincaré.
It was very illuminating aspect anyway.
Finally, I'm not very happy with your answer about symmetry, because it's true that if the equations have no symmetry, the solution won't be symmetric. But if it's not symmetric, you'll have another solution.
Yes.
So you'll have two answers, so you have no limit, no definite answer. Okay, we can discuss.
No. No, so the point of Poincaré is that any distribution function for the spin gives a limit. But the point of Poincaré is that this limit does not depend on the initial spin. Now, if you use this symmetry argument, it will tell you that there may be always a limit depending on the initial spin. And this is not what Poincaré is saying. Poincaré is saying this: there is a limit independently of the initial spin. That is a wonderful idea. I don't know the law, but I know the solution. This is a wonderful thing. I think this is a very fundamental idea in dynamical systems. Huh? You can answer questions even without knowing the data.
Yes, I have a question which maybe is connected to Rainer's comment. You made very clear that you consider that there is much more in Poincaré's approach to probability than what has usually been commented by historians or mathematicians and so on. But then at some point, you mentioned that actually there is everything in Poincaré's work.
And this is my péché mignon.
And so this is connected to a discussion we had yesterday with Alain Chancinaire. So this idea that, it can be striking when you read Poincaré or some other writings that you find everything in a way. Yeah. Of course, Reinhardt mentioned the fact that, for instance, you don't have Lebesgue measure. And of course, you mentioned yourself that you don't have the notion of mixing, for instance, and so on. So I would be interested to know what you think is crucial in this world story that you do not have, you do not see in Poincaré's approach to probability.
Uh-huh. You know, what's crucial today in dynamics and that I don't find there? Of course, there is no stable foliation, there is no oscillated theorem.
But in the sense
in
responding to Reinhardt, you said that the fact that you do not have Lebesgue measure, for instance, it's not a main issue.
Yes.
Okay. So what would be a main issue that could maybe explain the fact that it was not understood?
As we heard in Jacot's talk, basically you have two main phenomena to understand dynamical system. It's expansion and folding. Expansion is there. Folding is not there. I mean, I didn't see any kind of folding in Poincaré's paper. And this is one of the two main ingredients in the modern theory of dynamical systems. So this is, I didn't see it, at least. Okay, I want to apologize. I mean, you are historians, I'm not. Obviously, I'm reading Poincaré with my eyes of mathematician, and I obviously see things that I want to see. And this is, it's a fundamental error that mathematicians do, but I can guarantee that the last chapter of this book, really, you have precise definitions of mixing, you have precise definition of ergodicity, you have the fact that mixing implies ergodic, you have examples of mixing non-ergodic, ergodic non-mixing. You have all these examples, and you have the conjecture of the Birkhoff ergodic theorem is there. So, and you have the this the the stunt this conjecture that a generic, that a dynamic volume preserving dynamical system should be ergodic unless there is an invariant function. Well, this is there. This is not in my imagination.
just to mention the fact that I don't think it's an error. I think it's a very important dynamic in the history of mathematics, the fact that you have various readings of the same text, of course. Sure. But then it's important also to know what you don't see.
Sure, of course.
So did Berkhoff read it?
What?
Berkhoff.
Yes.
Did he read?
This I don't know. You know, Birkhoff is supposed to be many experts here, but I think Birkhoff is officially the best follower of Poincaré. So Birkhoff read Poincaré, no doubt. I mean, he wrote his papers in French, so there was no linguistic problem. Did Birkhoff read this book? I doubt it, because it's not easy to find. It's not in the collected papers. Well, it's not published. I mean, you have to find it somewhere in some... What? I have no idea. And also, there's this big problem that when you borrow a book in the library, usually, but I don't take care if it's first edition, second edition, but these two editions are very different.
Other questions or comments? Oh, thank you, Etienne.